probably this week I would not have done even $12 an hour.
I mean, I have to go home and tell my husband I earned only $50.
Bloody well, $5.28.
Anita, what happened here today?
Today we had our very first union meeting of union delegates.
The road is a workplace. Thousands of us earn a living out here. Trucks, couriers, taxis, rideshares. And many of those people have worked in a kind of nowhere land. Contract workers. No paid annual leave, no sick pay, not even sometimes making minimum wage. Almost as if out here, labour laws don't apply. But that's changing. And this is the story of how and why.
We had delegates in Auckland and Wellington and Christchurch, and so they all came together, you know, partly over Zoom, but also in person. We had, you know, discussions about how we're going to organise Uber drivers around Aotearoa.
They say the revolution will not be televised, but we were here, on the corner, sunshine making a precious appearance. Uber's New Zealand union delegates holding their first ever meeting, just like the sign said.
Thank you so much, guys.
It was small, but the fact an Uber union with driver delegates even exists is an acorn of sorts.
Your passengers are going to support you.
And it all started with an extraordinary employment court judgment, which said four Uber drivers were not independent contractors, but employees.
Our victory against Uber, which was the 25th of October last year, so it's only been a few months.
And how many members do you have now?
We've got slightly over 700 at the moment, which is pretty good going, I think.
How many hours do you do a week?
At least 50.
And how much money do you make after expenses?
Oh, after expenses, I might not even take $800.
Have you worked this morning?
Yes.
And how much did you make?
$50 here.
$50 for how many hours?
6:30 till 10:30.
4 hours?
4 hours.
$50?
$50.
Before expenses?
Before expenses. And
That's $12.50 an hour. Tell me about your working day as a rule. What time do you start?
I usually drop my son off to school in the morning and start around 9-ish in the and finish by 9 o'clock in the night.
9 till 9?
9 till 9, 12 hours. With approximately 1 hour of break, yeah, for sure.
And how many days a week do you do that?
I have to do 6 days at least to make the ends.
What? You do 6 days?
6 days, yeah.
So you're potentially working, 6 12s is 72, minus an hour for lunch, you're potentially working 65 hour weeks routinely?
Routinely.
Uber's brilliance is that it looks like a transport company, but that's make-believe. For the most part, the drivers own the cars. Uber's vehicle is the app. 23 million times a day, the app puts people and drivers together, and Uber gets a cut every time. Genius. But...
Okay, thank you. Terry, it's so nice to see you. Thank you so much for having us.
Kia ora.
That's Terry Boucher. He's a tax expert. He runs a tax consultancy.
Okay, people smile.
He helps people pay the right amount of tax, no more than is due, which is fair. It's how tax ought to work.
Minimising tax is part of business. It's, you know, what about people ask me to do? People want to pay the right amount of tax.
Uber's drivers pay the right amount of tax. Tax pays for the roads Uber drives on. And as Terry Boucher was looking at how much tax Uber itself pays, he saw that Uber was effectively two companies in New Zealand, one called Razia, one called Porsche.
Porsche, which is runs the Uber Eats operation, and then Razia runs the normal Uber operation.
Two companies, both 100% owned by Uber International Holdings, which is based in the Netherlands. In fact, they have no Uber office here at all. How's business going?
The income from both of them, the revenue from the contracts between the two of them is about $220 million in the December 21 year.
That's not bad revenue for a company with no New Zealand office.
Revenue of 220 mil.
Yes, but taxable income for the two, between them, 2 million.
Revenue of 220, taxable income of 2.
Yes. Tax paid $545,000.
To help us understand that, Vinay and Yishuan have made us this. Each of these Ubers represents $1 million revenue. So 220 cars, $220 million. And tax, $545,000 paid. That's just over half of one car.
Is that legal? Yes, it is. Is it moral? Different question. You decide. But Terry Boucher says they're being watched. Really watched.
These are under intense scrutiny by tax authorities all the time. And Uber has been the subject of several of these. So are Google, by the way. And
Apple?
Apple, yep. They all are.
So this is base erosion and profit shifting?
Yes, the BEPS initiative, as it is. Well, base erosion is, the basis here is in New Zealand. It's being eroded by profit shifting to another jurisdiction.
And so you put your costs where tax rates are high and you declare your profits where tax rates are low? Is it that simple?
Broadly speaking, yes.
Now, here's where we get back to the drivers and their workplace, our streets. Because the more Terry Boucher looked at Uber, the less he liked what he saw, not just in tax paid or not, but in the way it treats its drivers too.
I am dubious about the long-term future of Uber as an actual business model.
Why is that?
Because I think much of it's the reason it tries to work is it's trying to smash through the regulations, bypass the regulations to bypass the costs. And one of the key costs, for example, is employee costs.
And this is where Uber are hitting speed bumps. Gedunk. Less with tax than with people. Let's have an example. If you are a driver with Uber doing, say, 50 hours a week, and plenty of drivers do that many hours, are you a contractor, as Uber claims, or are you an employee?
Can you tell me about the employment court case? And I just want to read from the conclusion. Paragraph 93. Each of the plaintiff drivers was in an employment relationship when carrying out driver work for Uber. What does that mean, Anita?
It means that it doesn't matter what label Uber put on that relationship with its drivers at the time. The law has looked at the reality of the relationship and determined that it was an employment relationship, and therefore those drivers were entitled to all of the things that you should get as an employee in New Zealand.
It's important to note that this case determined the status of only four drivers, not every Uber driver, and Uber is seeking leave to appeal. It's also important to remind you that some Uber drivers are doing it as a side hustle, so they don't want to be employees. They're quite happy to be contractors. But this is still a very important victory, and it's indicative of how the tide is turning on Uber's contractor employment model in many parts of the world.
Quite a bit of, I looked at Uber's filings for 2022, and its commitments and contingencies runs to four pages. And when you look at it here, there's all sorts of questions about driver classification. It's got suits going on in California.
Essentially a version of what the employment court was asked to judge on here. Are drivers employees or contractors?
Switzerland, Swiss social security rulings.
There, Switzerland's highest court ruled drivers are employees.
The Massachusetts authority in there, Spain's got a labour audit going on. They've got state unemployment taxes issues in the New Jersey Department of Labour, California, New York, and it goes on and on.
If Uber has a poster child location where the gig economy spins like a fruit machine, it's maybe at our biggest airports. Here it's Auckland, but it could be Wellington or Christchurch. A tide of industry, people, cars, money. This is what drivers must imagine when they sign on. The work not stopping, the people and the money flooding in. Ka-ching. This is where they wait before they get to the front of the queue. The airport provides an area with facilities, otherwise they'd be parked on a street or circling somewhere. But in the gig economy, when you wait for work, you are not being paid. And and sometimes you wait for hours.
So you've been waiting 1.5 to 2 hours and you've gone roughly halfway up the queue?
Correct.
So that means you've got to wait another 1.5 to 2 hours?
Definitely. Yes.
And then if you get a fare into town, it's what, $50?
No, they give us 34. And if I'm lucky, if I get a fare to town, if I get a fare to Papatoi or Mangere, I'll be ending up with $15, which is not even $5 per hour.
Oh, man. After 3 o'clock, I feel like so frustrated. And especially if I get a ride, say, for example, from Fenchurch Street to Hobson, it takes me at least half an hour, and I get paid bloody well $5.28.
Like 50 to 60 hours a week, but still can't make $1,200. And I have to pay 15% GST, income tax, and my car maintenance, rego, COF, and also petrol.
Yes, the sky may be the limit, but drivers aren't astronauts. Uber is not unique here, by the way. For years now, I've been talking to contract drivers earning below minimum wage. This is from RNZ's Checkpoint in 2018.
They're growing in number and at the bottom of the scale, an increasing number of them are earning less than the minimum wage.
That was 5 years ago, and that same year, a major survey found 3/4 of our rideshare drivers received less than the minimum wage after expenses.
Suppose I would drive 60, 70 hours, then it will be $1,200, $1,300 for 60, 70 hours. But if I drive like 10 hours or 15 hours...
Hold on, how much would you get for 60 or 70 hours?
Maybe $1,200, $1,300. That would be a good
And choice. That's before expenses?
Yes.
So 60 hours times $20 an hour is $1,200?
Yes. Yeah, it would be minimum wage.
What does Uber say about all of this? Well, I contacted their Sydney office, lots of emails. They don't have an office in New Zealand, by the way, to ask for an interview. My first email was to Emma Foley, Director, Driver and Marketplace for Australia and New Zealand. Here's what happened. I'm playing me, Emma Foley, and all the Uber people who emailed me or didn't are being played by the brilliant Rebecca Palmer, who was Nurse Dawn on Shortland Street.
Kia ora, Emma. I'm working on a story on Uber NZ in the context of the Employment Court decision of last year. Obviously, and importantly, I'd love to interview someone from Uber about this and wondered if you're the appropriate person. Emma, would you be available?
I'm 000 until 12th of May, spending some time with my family. For anything on New Zealand, please contact Anna. Regards, Emma.
Right, kia ora, Anna. I just received this email from Emma. Anna, in Emma's absence, would it be possible to interview you for this?
Hi, John. Thanks for reaching out. Anna is out of the office right now, but I wanted to see if I could be of some help. Thanks, Hayley.
Right, Hayley. Hi. Thanks for reaching back. The story picks up on the Employment Court decision. It will also widen out its look at Uber's overall operations in NZ, income tax paid staff, etc. All of it's based entirely on Uber's operations, so nothing you won't easily be able to answer.
Hi, John. Unfortunately, we don't have anyone available to do an on-camera interview at this time. Thanks, Hayley.
I contacted Uber.
Yes.
To try and get an interview, and they said to me, thank you for reaching out. I see when you contact Uber,
yes.
They say thank you for reaching out.
Yes.
So that's their kind of stock reply. That's what you get. Thank you for reaching out. Well, yeah. Uber, maybe you could reach back. What has Uber's response been to the Employment Court judgment?
Uber has applied to appeal the judgment, which is not a surprise, so we were expecting that, and we're still waiting to find out whether or not the Court of Appeal has approved or declined their application. But basically, you know, their response has been to, aside from applying to appeal it, more or less to ignore the judgment for the time being.
You don't have to answer this question. It's almost an unfair question to ask you because I'm asking for such a big moral judgment. But is Uber a good citizen as a business? Is this the kind of business we want?
My personal view is no.
When Uber arrived, it was hailed as an exemplar of how the gig economy could be a win-win, and maybe their shareholders still feel like winners. But let's end exactly where we started, with the thousands of us who work out here. And if they're sometimes not making minimum wage, if they don't get paid leave and sick pay, if they're working long hours and still not getting by, how is that considered roadworthy? Do you feel like Uber treats you like you're a person?
I don't think so. For them, everything is robots.
Robots?
Yeah.
So you're just another car on the road?
Absolutely. Absolutely.